millennials. I do want to say you brought up the truck stop ministry, and man, I am so thankful for the opportunity to have done that for these years. It is a small ministry. It's, you know, there's not much to it. We just go over there, greet people, put on a small sermon for them, and you know, it's usually a small crowd, but the people that you meet in that place, I mean, it'll change your life. And I'm absolutely just thankful for this, for the opportunity to preach in that ministry for the past few years. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn to the book of 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse number 9. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 9. I'll give you a second to turn. All right, when you get there, say amen. All right. But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. And indeed ye do it toward all the brethren which are in Macedonia. But we beseech you, brethren, that ye increase more and more, and that ye study to be quiet, and to do your own business, and to work with your own hands, as we commanded you, that ye may walk honestly toward them that are without, and that ye may have lack of nothing. Dear God, I pray right now that as I preach this short devotion, Lord, that you would bless it. It's not about me right now. It's not about what I have to say. It's all about you. It's all about saying what you've had for us in this passage, in this moment, what it can teach us, how it can help us to grow in our Christian lives and to grow together as a church. Lord, I just thank you for the people here. Thank you for the pastoral staff that's loved me and put so much into me. And Lord, I just thank you for all the blessings that you've given me in my life. Lord, just bless the preaching, and we love you, we praise you, and in Jesus' name I pray, amen. So, the Thessalonian church, if there was any example of a successful church, it would be this church right here. They're just a little city. It's around the coast of the east coast, northernmost of Greece. So they were real close to, like, you know, Macedonia, and he talks a lot about their interactions with the church of Macedonia, like in verse 10. And this was a church that made a difference in people's lives all across that part of the world. I think that they're a church that we can learn a lot from. I think there's a lot in the book of 1 Thessalonians that you could look at and you could say, that's something that I need to do. That's something that we as a church could grow in, something that we could get better at. And in this particular passage, that thing is brotherly love. Now, brotherly love, it actually comes from, two words. It comes from the word philia, which I'm sure you've heard that one, or phileo. It means, it's one of the Greek words for love. And then there's another one, and I like this one. It's adelphos. Adelphos means womb. What the word Philadelphia? Yeah. That's what the word is. Brotherly love. What the word Philadelphia means is not just brotherly love, but it means that you love each other in a way that you basically came from the same womb. And another way of putting that is we're all born of the Spirit. Or even if you want to, you know, take a different approach, we're all cut from the same cloth if we're Christians. We should have fellowship with one another. Now, I want to talk a little bit this evening about what brotherly love looks like. That's the title of my devotion. this evening. But the first thing I want to say about it is that Paul, in verse 9, he says, "Ye need not that I write unto you." Now, what he's basically saying is that this goes without saying. He even says, "For ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another." The simplest way that I can express that is that it is obvious. In fact, I would say it is one of, if not the most basic expressions of the sanctified Christian life. It is something that just by virtue of being a Christian, you should have, you should understand, and you should know. But it does help sometimes for us to look at it and say, okay, well, what does this look like when we're all together worshiping? What kind of actions are we going to see as a result of brotherly love? Now, love itself, I don't believe is an action. I believe that it is a state of being. Really, it's a way of living that you have this disposition towards people, right? It's both an emotional and a spiritual disposition, but it expresses itself in various ways that we can see. And so Paul lists a few ways here that that brotherly love expresses itself in the church. And the first, and honestly, I think it might be the most interesting one that I see, is he says that it's quiet. He says that you study to be quiet. Now, what does that mean? First off, it means, and it even says that you, and to do your own business. It minds its own business. Now, betrayal is a terrible thing. Let's look back at Satan, all right? And, okay, what caused him to sin? That was pride. What was Satan's sin? That was betrayal, all right? And, I mean, that's depicted, one of the best depictions of that is Dante. Satan is pictured in hell with all the traitors, like Judas Iscariot, all of those people who were dearly beloved by somebody and bit them in the back, stabbed them in the back. And there's a kind of betrayal that we don't really often pay much attention to, or at least we don't see it as betrayal, and that's gossip. Now, gossip loves to run its mouth. I'm not going to say that I'm perfect in this area either. I can think of plenty of times that I talked about someone or, ran my mouth when I shouldn't have. But gossip is betraying somebody with your lips. And therefore, gossip is one of the most satanic things we can do, especially as a church body, especially as people who should be unified with one another. And another thing about that quietness is that, as he says, it works with his hands. Now, I had some trouble with that one, but what I believe that it means is understanding that you're only a part of the whole. So say you're a hand, and say, this is another Pauline example, say you're a hand, somebody else is an arm, or you're an eye and somebody else is an ear. The eye should not be trying to take over what it's the ear's responsibility to do. Nor should the ear be trying to take the eye's responsibility. We all have our own part to play. There is no room in a church, in a truly unified church that has brotherly love, for ambition, for trying to place yourself above another and not work with others. Even as a pastor, even as me being a preacher, it is not my position to say I am better than you. Okay, there's plenty of preachers that are way worse than a lot of their congregants, but that doesn't mean, like, that is the preacher's position. He is responsible for that. He will stand before God because of that work. And maybe you are a bus worker, maybe you are a Sunday school teacher, whatever you may be, that is what you will stand before God for. So, trying to hurry here because I'm spending a little bit too much time, but also it is honest. Brotherly love has integrity. You might even say that it stands on its own two feet and that it lacks nothing. Another way of putting that is, from a spiritual standpoint, a person who has brotherly love and a person who is honest does not compromise. Now, that doesn't mean does not change, because if you're wrong, you're wrong and you need to change. But we don't compromise, all right? We stand in unity because of our shared beliefs, because of our shared love for one another, because of our shared cause, especially the cause of reaching people with the gospel. And from a physical standpoint, we all have to contribute, all right? We have to stand on our own two feet. We have to have that integrity as well, because if any part of the body leaves, the whole body is, I mean, that can be deadly to the whole body. So, and it shows itself also to those that are without. You know, it's not just for Christians. I mean, when you're honest before non-believers, they notice. When you're a Christian before non-believers, they notice. When you love them as you would love yourself, they notice. That's why the prosperity gospel doesn't work. You know, when they see us saying that life will be all fine and dandy if you just believe, and then they believe and life isn't all fine and dandy, that's a perfect way to get somebody to fall away real fast. Instead, it's a cross to take up. We need to be honest about that. We need to have integrity, and we need to love these people as ourselves no matter how hard it is. And lastly, it's unifying force. He says, towards all the brethren in Macedonia. They did not keep God's blessings to themselves. Just because God blessed their church does not mean that they went all over, that, or does not mean that they kept it, that they held it from others. No, they spread the blessings all over the Macedonian area. They helped other churches, and they were mission-minded. So my question is, do we have brotherly love in this church? I think in large part we do. I think there's certainly places where we're lacking. Many of us as individuals lack, and I as an individual lack. But do we quietly work for God, or do we seek attention from our peers? Do we have integrity of heart? Are we honest and vulnerable even to our enemies? And do we have spiritual unity? Are we more concerned about our own success, or do we rejoice in the success of others? And that's all I have.